Inflation trick, the indicator that actually matters. The outcome leaves you baffled and confused. No matter the language or culture, magicians have performed sleight-of-hand tricks to wow audiences around the globe for centuries. The magician's goal is to reveal a chosen reality to the audience, while concealing the real methods and actions that bring the magic trick to life. Two important factors play into sleight-of-hand. The first is misdirection, which focuses the audience's attention on something of no significance, drawing all their attention away from the trick. The second factor is the slick alteration of an object or sly movement that's nearly impossible to detect. Economists, especially those that track inflation statistics, are specialists at sleight of hand. Now you see it, and now you don't. Economic inflation magic. According to Trading Economics, the annualized inflation rate in the US was 1.7% in February. But if you're wondering just how much your grocery and your restaurant, car, insurance, energy, renovation, or other bills are rising higher and higher by, especially over the last year, there's one chart that can tell you where to look. Over the last year, commodity returns were overwhelmingly positive, and many have experienced very large percentage increases. That's the chart you're looking at right now, which is just the one-year commodity returns, going from LNG, which has been the best performer, all the way down to the worst performer, which is coking coal. Energy led the charge, and a lot of food-based commodities like oats, soybeans, corn, and sugar have experienced large increases. With these massive price appreciations, is it feasible that the prices continue to go even higher? Did we just see an inflection point where the trend accelerates and we hit super cycle status? The inflation indicator that actually matters. When you mention inflation, the first thing that comes to mind of most investors, novice and veteran alike, is the CPI. You probably already know the CPI as the Consumer Price Index, a widely watched measure of inflation. But if you're a veteran resource investor, you should be paying attention to the Bank of Canada's Real Commodity Price Index instead. The Bank of Canada's CPI is a commodity price index that includes energy, metals, agriculture, fisheries, and timber markets all combined into one representative index. That's the chart you're looking at right now, is the Bank of Canada's commodity price index going back to 1870. You'll find that we're near the lows in real inflation adjusted terms for global commodities. As you can see, we have a long way to go just to get back to previous highs, let alone surpass them and create new highs for commodity price in real terms. Remember, that's the key fact. Major price movements in commodities aren't based on technical breakouts or breakdowns. Instead, they're based on supply and demand fundamentals. Answering questions like, is there enough future supply to sustain demand, present major clues to potential upcoming moves in the commodity space. Future supply cannot be created out of thin air. It starts with long, hard, and usually unsuccessful exploration activity, financing and making money from future demand. Math matters. Understanding the risks associated to a project and properly adjusting the valuations to reflect the real risk associated to the project is critical to be successful in mining. Like I said, math matters. And most in the business, that is mining, absolutely suck at math. This is the number one mistake in the mining business today, hands down. And nobody is talking about it except Katusa Research. There is no way you can price the risk for a project in the DRC, that's the Democratic Republic of Congo or Argentina, the same as a permitted deposit in Ontario or BC, which is in Canada, or Nevada in the USA. But yet, the big brokerage firms do just that. Why? Because they are in the business of selling you paper. And pesky details like risk-adjusted analysis makes it very difficult for the bankers to sell you paper. Now, the chart you're looking at right now shows the equity financings for junior and mid-tier gold and base metal companies since the global financial crisis in 2008. You can see that the financing levels are down over 50% from their highs. The gold line is gold equity financings and the black line is base metals. You can obviously see it's harder and harder to raise money in the mining sector. Thus, the real critical flaws are being overlooked, as the real amount of capital that would be raised if people understood the risk would even be lower than it is today. Less money raised obviously means less exploration and less development being done to delineate new gold or base metal mines. Less mines means lower future supply, and lower future supply is bullish for long-term prices. Hence the old cache saying, the cure for low prices is low prices. Well, why don't we just build more mines and create more supply, you may ask. The government did it with money. It's not that easy. How long does it take to build a mine, you should ask? The answer? A long time. If the company is successful at finding a good deposit, and many aren't, remember, one in every 3,000 exploration targets becomes an actual eventual mine. Those are really bad odds. It can take over 10 years to develop a mine from exploration, then get permits, and then finance, and then finally build the mine. How many of the gurus in our financial mining markets have been involved from start to finish of actually putting their name to a mine from start to finish, like joining the board of directors or being on the executive team? How many gurus in the mining space who write newsletters have done just that? I have. I was the largest individual investor in Copper Mountain when we took the company public in 2007, and I was a member of the board of directors and was there from concept to exploration to becoming Canada's third largest copper producer. I retired from Copper Mountain 13 years to the day of joining it. Copper Mountain went from an idea to mine in 4 years. That is a very rare event. Realistically, it's closer to 15 years to put a mine into production. That's the table that we're showing you right now, from the exploration stage to actual production. In a world where financings are dwindling and less money is being put to work on finding new deposits, projects currently in the development stage have become highly sought after. Now let's take a closer look at the copper market. The price of copper can affect everything from the cost of plumbing in your home to the cost of an electric vehicle. Below is a chart of the Bloomberg Global Copper Producers Average Reserve Grade. As you can see, the trend is your friend. Just 20 years ago, the average grade was hovering around 0.8%. It's half that today. You'll see that even at existing mines, copper grades have fallen 50% since the year 2000. That means miners are obtaining half the copper from a ton of ore relative to what they did per ton 20 years ago. The big boom. High prices are only sustainable through a boom in commodity demand. With close to $10 trillion printed around the world thus far, and you know there's going to be more printed, governments are doing their best to prop up and energize their economies. This much printing of money creates a somewhat artificial increase in prices. Remember, the numerator, denominator, right? Math matters. But tangible and sustainable price appreciations in commodities must come from fundamental demand and supply metrics. Electrification of the economy will play a key role and will be central determinant if this super cycle is the real deal, or if this is simply a one-year hurrah followed by subsequent bust. I believe that this time around, a rising tide will not lift all boats. Some commodities are destined to be in bear markets forever. I've talked about the curtain calls of certain dirty metals. Substitution risk amongst commodities is incredibly high, yet it's disregarded by many gurus and analysts. I'm just putting the finishing touches on a very important upcoming report. I will be detailing where I believe the true boom in commodities is going to be for my subscribers. If you're looking for a way to get invested in the commodity space, Katusa Research provides comprehensive and, most importantly, actionable advice. I've been in the industry for about 20 years now, financed hundreds of deals, and have literally been on the teams that have built mines. I've invested millions of dollars into the commodity-focused businesses that I believe can generate incredible returns, and my track record speaks for itself. If you want to get ahead of the curve, click here to find out more about Katusa's resource opportunities. Please stay safe.